Okay, let's get started. Welcome, everyone. This is the first talk of the seminar of our Georgetown Chinese Politics and Economic Research Seminar Series. My name is Li Zhiliu. I am an assistant professor at the McDonald School of Business. Another co-organizer of this speaker events is Professor Ning Leng at the McCourt School of Public Policy, who's also in the audience. The talk series is co-sponsored by the Georgetown Initiative for U.S.-China Dialogue on Global Affairs, and also the Government Department. Today, it's my great pleasure to introduce Xiao Ma, Assistant Professor of Political Science at Peking University. His research focuses on comparative political institutions, political development, political economy of development, and Chinese politics. He has published on top journals in the China field and other general interest journals, such as the China Quarterly, Journal of Contemporary China, and Studies in Comparative International Development. Today, he's going to present his first book, Localized Bargaining, which is published at Oxford University Press in 2022. It uses China's high-speed railway program, one of the world's largest infrastructure projects in human history, to examine how intergovernmental bargaining between China's central and local governments operate. This political dynamics of bargaining applies widely, not only to these infrastructure programs, but also to many other public projects in China. In today's talk, Xiao will present about 40 minutes and save the rest of the time for Q&A. If you have a clarification question, feel free to raise your hand and ask. But if you have a more substantive or longer question, please save it to the Q&A after the presentation. Thank you again, Xiao, for accepting our seminar invitation, especially do the talk when it is 1 a.m. in Peking time. The floor is yours.
Okay. Thank you, Li Zhi, for the very kind introduction. I also want to thank Professor Leng Ying and Professor Liu Li Zhi for inviting me to this event. This is the first time I am doing a book talk outside of China since the publication. And as Li Zhi mentioned, that today's talk is based on my book published last year. So the question motivates my book. The subject that motivates my book is China's high-speed railway project. In 2004, the State Council released the medium to long-term railway network plan. That's the beginning for China's high-speed railway construction. In the next 18 years, the mileage, the operating mileage of China's high-speed railway grew from zero to over 40,000 kilometers. So to put that number in context, so that's twice the length of those in any other countries combined. To build this extensive network, Chinese government invests more than 800 billion yuan per year in rail infrastructure. That's roughly 120 billion US dollars. In 1991, the Department of Transportation of the United States released a report and shows that the interstate highway system cost in total over a period of four decades, roughly 260 billion US dollars. That's in current dollar. So by different metrics, we can say the high-speed railway network in China is the largest infrastructure program in human history. We, however, see significant regional variations in the rollout of this program. The left figure shows the number of high-speed railway stations per million people by 2020, and we see a significant variation exist across province. The right figure shows the number of high-speed railway stations by cities in the same year, and we see not necessarily the places with most population or the largest size of economy has the most stations. The more prominent variation exists in terms of the speed to which different places gets their stations. So here I want to recount a story published on the official newspaper of Yancheng in 2019, recounting the story how the city gets its first high-speed railways. So in 2008, Jiangsu provincial government announced the plan to build a high-speed railway that connects Xuzhou and Huai'an, two cities located in the northern part of the province. While the coastal city Yancheng, a city with a size of population of 8 million, was left out of the plan. So when the news reached the city, the leadership and the population of the city react strongly to this news. They believe they are more qualified to receive a station than the neighboring city of Huai'an, which I think have only half of the population and roughly 60% of in terms of is the size of the economy. So what the leadership of Yancheng did at the time is that they quickly got mobilized. The official newspaper says the leaders, the mayors, and the party secretary of the cities visited tirelessly the provincial capital city of Nanjing as well as the capital city in Beijing. They sent reports to the ministries in the capital cities and trying to make a case that this railway should go through their cities. And the newspaper report says these reports they made pile up like a mountain. So the efforts of the Yancheng seems to pay off in 2011. In that year, the provincial government in Jiangsu agreed in principle that the railway between Xuzhou and Huai'an will have an extension into the city. But before Yancheng people could celebrate, they learned that this segment, this extension segment only have a designing speed of 160 kilometers per hour, much lower than the designing speed than the minimum designing speed for high speed railway, which is 200 kilometers per hour. So at the time, Yancheng leaders again were mobilized. Beijing went to the National Development and Reform Commission, a very powerful regulatory agencies overseeing the construction of infrastructure, trying to argue for an upgrade of the railway. So the city's effort paid off. In 2013, the NDRC, the National Development and Reform Commission, agreed to upgrade the designing speed of this segment of railway to 200 kilometers per hour. And in 2015, when the railway formally began construction, the NDRC again upgrade the speed of this segment of railway to 200 kilometers per hour, same as the rest. So in 2019, in December 2019, the Xuzhou-Huai'an-Yancheng high-speed railway finally began operation. So that's 11 years since the initial plans. While only 200 meters south of Yancheng, the high-speed railway connects Hangzhou and Shanghai, only took 20 months from finalizing the even cause such phenomenon a war for high-speed railway. So that's the story, or that's the subject that motivates my book, which is based on my dissertation research that I conducted over the past years. So the question I initially want to ask is, what is behind the spatial and temporal variation in the high-speed rollout in China? So some audience, if you're not a social scientist, you might wonder if this is a question that political scientists should pursue. And this seems to be a question that engineer should pursue. But in fact, in questions regarding to the allocation of public resources, such as the construction of roads, the construction of schools, the construction of railways, it pertains to the allocation of public funds. In different parts of the world, we see politics play a very major role in shaping the allocation of these resources, and railway is not an exception. So here I want to use one example in Japan, where I spent my undergraduate years to illustrate how politics can influence rail infrastructure. So this railway is called the Ofunato Line, and it is located in the northeastern prefecture of Iwate in Japan. This railway was first constructed back in 1920s. When this railway was first proposed, the designing route should go straight from west to east, connecting two major population centers as shown on the map in two blue dots directly. But at the time, the member of the House of Representatives, the parliament of the prefecture, the legislator of the prefecture happened to born in the northern part. So he wants this railway to go through his hometown and located in the northern part of the prefecture. So what he did is that he exerted his political influence, and the consequence is what we see as a result on this map. The railway takes an inverted U-turn on this railway and have this very weird shape on the map. And a similar distortion of railway construction were very frequent and were very, very common in Japan, to the extent there is even a Japanese word to describe such phenomenon. In Japanese, the word is pronounced as garen in tetsu, means to pull the railway into my electoral strong base. So this story is a very typical example of pork barrel politics, or more generally, clientelistic distribution of public infrastructure. We all know China shares a very different political system with Japan and other electoral democracies, in which politicians use infrastructure benefits to buy off support. So what's the story in China? Before I tell you my argument, I want to quickly go through the existing explanation in China, but also in other countries. The first explanation, I call it the patronage explanations, namely political leaders, either in electoral democracy or in autocracy, they use resources in hand, such as investment in infrastructure or positions or bank loans, etc., to benefit their supporters. These supporters can be voters, can also be close associates or other important political actors. The second explanation, I would call it the technocratic planning argument, because building a high-speed railway or any similar infrastructure project involves a lot of technicalities. For example, the geology of the areas where the railway will go through, the safety measures and other issues. Specialized bureaucrats in different bureaucracies, they are responsible for the regulations and plannings of these issues. And their calculations and their incentives, behaviors, have a big role in determining how the investment will be allocated. And we can trace this line of research back to when people study the economic takeoff in Japan back in the 1980s. I argue that these two lines of explanations, they have limitations. The first limitation is the information problems. For either for a patronage explanation or for a technocratic planning explanations, the decision makers, either a politician or a bureaucrat, they need information to make informed decisions. In electoral democracy, election per se is a device where information can be generated. Politicians can look at the distribution of votes across the country and decide where they should spend resources to boost up support. But in China, we know we don't have a competitive election as those in the West. So where do politicians or bureaucrats get information? The second issue with regard to these explanations is the credible commitment problem that are pervasive in non-democratic regimes. So in the patronage argument, a crucial piece of argument is that a politician can punish voters if the voter don't vote in accordance with the clientelistic packages or the deals. For example, if the politician find out the voter is not vote in support of the politician can retract the benefit associated in the district in the next round. But for infrastructure benefits like railways, once the benefit is delivered, once the railway is built, the benefit associated with infrastructure can hardly be retracted, right? Unless if you demolish the railway. So there is a credible commitment problem inherent in these kind of exchange. So we cannot use a paid explanation to explain such variations. So how can we explain the distribution of such benefit in the context of China? So in my book, as you can find out in the book title, I coined this concept called localized bargaining. Okay, so this concept refers to bottom-up bargaining activities to gain access by the territorial administrations to more policy resources. The reason I use localized, the term localized, is for two reasons. First, in these bargainings, localities are seeking very specific benefits in their own jurisdictions. They are not seeking to, for example, overturn or rewrite the general arrangement in central-local relationship in China. Secondly, differ from collective bargaining, which people are more familiar with. In these bargainings, people are not teaming up together, or these localities, they are not teaming up together. In fact, localities close to each other oftentimes are very fierce competitors with each other. So their strategy of bargainings are oftentimes very localized. So for an audience in the US, what I just described will immediately sounds familiar to you as intergovernmental lobbying. Indeed, in countries, in a federalist countries like China and the US, government do lobby other government. In US, state government lobby the federal government, and the city government also lobby the state and the federal government. But I would also argue that localized bargaining is also different from intergovernmental lobbying that people commonly know in the context of United States. First, they are not public. These behaviors, they are not well documented in government archives. Second, as we will review later, the strategy local government employ in China is much more diverse and less institutionalized compared with local government in the United States. So why localized government, why localized bargaining took place in the first place? I think there are two major reasons, one on the part of local government, the other on the more macro institutional environment. On the part of local government, we see leaders, they have their career incentives. They want to achieve economic growth, fulfilling key performance indicators in terms of fiscal revenues, investment, et cetera, and pulling these white elephant project to their jurisdictions can fulfill these target and contributes to their career advancement. Even for leaders who don't have much career ambitions, these projects are very beneficial to local departments. For example, the transportation departments, the local national development and local development and reform commissions, the state-owned enterprises that will benefit from the contract of these construction contract of these project. When these large projects were drawn to localities, these departments, they get a larger budget. They have a bigger payroll. So they will also benefit from these projects. So even the major main local leaders, such as mayor or county executive, they're not interested in these projects. Their subordinates in these departments will also push them to pursue these projects. And of course, high-speed railway has become a very popular method of travel among Chinese peoples. And Chinese people also express their desire for the ability to use this kind of infrastructure online and offline. And this kind of public pressure also can move local officials' actions. So in the process of doing field work, I talk about these incentives to a local leader. Okay, so these are things that has been very well studied by our colleagues in the Chinese politics field. Everyone, I think if you are a specialist in Chinese politics, you should be familiar with this. But when I talked to a Chinese officials, he dismissed these incentives. He says, you scholars often think we are lazy or we have to be incentivized in order to do things. And this local leader, he is a retired mayor in central China. He said, it is also possible that officials truly wants to accomplish something when they're in office. And pulling these large projects to their jurisdictions is one way to have this kind of fulfillment. So I added this, the fourth item here, the inner calling of officials. In addition to this incentive on the part of local officials, localized bargaining also appear in China because of some macro institutional elements. So despite the fact that China is a very decentralized country, central government in China still controls crucial policy resources. So if local governments wants to build, invest in a large scale infrastructure project, or if a project, the amount of investment involved in the project exceeds certain limit, localities will need to receive approval from the central authorities before they can invest in this project. Even if the locality has the resources to do this project by themselves. And some localities, if they are underfunded, they also rely on central transfers or other subsidies to carry out this project. But in the meantime, local government in China lacks formal channels to influence central policymakers. So Chinese legislature, the National People's Congress, is often characterized as a rubber stamp. And the most important institution where most economic and social policies were made in China, the State Council, only constitutes of functional ministries, such as Ministry of Transportation, Ministry of Railways, the National Development Reform Commissions. And in these State Council meetings, only ministers were attending. Chinese localities, the provinces, the cities, they were not represented in these meetings. So back in the 1990s, China scholar Susan Shirk famously noted in her influential book, The Political Logic of Economic Reform, she says, there is a disenfranchisement of localities in state council decision makings. This also gave rise to extra institutional methods of lobbying or bargaining in order to influence decision makers. Also very important is that even within the central authority, there is a fragmented authority. There's not a unified, coherent decision maker within the central government. Instead, decision-making process in the central government is characterized by fragmentation. So this is also very classical in the field of Chinese politics, the fragmented authoritarian thesis that many important colleagues before us have already laid the foundation. So here I want to use the example to illustrate this fragmented authoritarianism in high-speed railway construction. So if a locality wants to build a high-speed railway, the locality needs to go through the following procedure. So the first, a province needs to submit a report to the National Development and Reform Commission, the Ministry of Railway, now the China Railway Cooperation, and the Ministry of Transport. These three ministries will determine if this proposal is appropriate to be included in the medium to long-term railway network plan. So after these three ministries agree to include this proposed railways, the province can move on to actually designing that railway. The province will need to submit a preliminary feasibility report, a project suggestion report, project feasibility report, project design, and each of these reports will be vetted by different ministries in the State Council. For example, the project feasibility report will be evaluated independently by the National Development and Reform Commission, the Ministry of Transport, the Ministry of Environment and Ecology, and the Ministry of Natural Resources. Each of these ministries are responsible for a very specific aspect of this project. For example, the Ministry of Natural Resources is responsible for assessing the amount of land that will be requisitioned for the project. And the Ministry of Environment and Ecology is responsible for evaluating the environmental impact, such as noise, et cetera, of this project. And if one ministry disagree on this project in any of these steps, project cannot move on. Okay, so and these ministries, they do not necessarily agree with each other all the time. So here I want to use two examples to show how these kind of fragmented authority ambitions to pursue this railway project. So on the left, there's a map showing the high-speed railway that connects Beijing and Harbin, which began construction in 2009. But the segments that connects Beijing and Shenyang were delayed. The construction were delayed for 5 years. The main reason for the delay was that the residents along the route worried that the construction of the railway will bring noise to their property and reduce the value of their home. So they kept submitting letters to the Ministry of Environmental Protection. Now the ministry was transformed into, or was reorganized into the Ministry of Ecology and Environment. So because the residents were submitting these complaint letters, the Ministry of Environmental Protection rejects the proposal four times, rejects the proposal submitted by the localities four times, causing a major delay on the construction of these segments of the railway. So the right figure shows a picture of Shanghai Hangzhou Maglift. You see, this is an animated picture. The reason I use this picture is because this railway was never built. But in fact, the Shanghai Hangzhou Maglift train was approved for a project suggestion report back in 2006. The reason the project never actually moved beyond is that after 2006, Ministry of Railway, one of the main ministries involved in the construction of the railway network, decided that they don't want to use the maglev technology. Instead, the Ministry of Railway decided to use the traditional wheeled electric powered train that we see that are running in China today. So this train never gets built, even though it received approval from all the other ministries. So because these ministries, they can disagree with each other, and these ministries are very powerful, they serve as the veto players. So that's why local government needs to bargain with each individual ministries and try to strike consensus among them in order for them to pursue these benefits. And it's actually not a big secret in China. We see a tip of iceberg of these bargainings from here to there on newspaper reports. For example, each year, local government sends a lot of the people into this ministry, try to convince the bureaucrats in this ministry that their project is appropriate and investment should be allocated to their localities. In the process of doing research, I noticed where these localities are sending, when these localities are sending these officials to the central government, try to convince the bureaucrats. Most of these officials stay in the Beijing office of their localities in Beijing. And this is a road sign in Beijing pointing to these Beijing offices. And it's like domestic embassies for Chinese localities. So through talks and interviews with officials in Beijing offices, I get a sense of how localities are engaged, how localities engage in localized bargainings. The most straightforward ways is to send documents and reports to these ministries using statistics and other rationales to try to convince these bureaucrats. But these reports can be very lengthy. Okay, so a few months ago, I read another environmental evaluation report of a newly constructed railway. That environmental evaluation report alone has 928 pages, and that's only for environmental impact evaluations. And the railway construction is only one thing among many others that our local government are negotiating with central authorities. And you can imagine thousands of such reports are sending to the ministries every day by the 330 cities across China. Okay, but in the ministry, there's very limited manpower. Only a very tiny portion of them will actually be read, and even fewer will be replied. Of course, localities also rely on informal connections. One type of informal connections is job transfers. For example, if a municipal party secretary used to work in a central ministry, then this kind of experience serves as a very valuable asset for localities, because this mayor or this party secretary will know who calls the shots and who the localities should send the report. And his personal a connection that formed during his previous work experience also can help expedite the speed of process of these reports. So here I want to use another example, show how informal connections locality have can help speed up the process in the central bureaucracy. So here I show a map of the railway connects Lanzhou and Chongqing, and the railway is called Lanyu Railway. In 1994, 25 cities and counties along the railway, they submit a report to the National Planning Commission in the State Council. So that's the predecessor to the National Development and Reform Commission, proposing this railway to the State Council. But like the majority of such proposals sent by localities to the State Council, this report was sent without receiving a reply. 4 years later, in 1998, these 25 localities, they again submit a report to the State Council. But this time, in the same report they submit to the State Council, they also collect 105 signatures. These signatures are those retired Red Army soldiers who were born in these cities at the time who were still alive. Among these Red Army soldiers were founding generals, were generals who were conferred the rank of generals in 1955. In China, these group of generals were considered as the founding fathers of the People's Republic of China. And that report reached the desk of then Premier Zhu Rongji, who directed the Minister of Railway and the Director of the National Planning Commission to expedite the research on this railway project. And this railway eventually began construction in the 2000, and the railway began operation in 2017. So inspired by this story, me and my colleague Ji Chengyuan, who is an associate professor of political science at Shanghai Jiao Tong University, we collect the entirety of counties in China, the 2,800 counties in China. And we look at whether they were built, whether they were given a high-speed railway station. And also we counted the amount of time each county spent before they get a station. And after controlling other things such as GDPs or distance to the nearest airport, or whether the county has traditional railways, we find that everything else equal, if a county has a surviving revolutionaries in that county, then it significantly increased the chance of that county in getting a high-speed railway station. This is one study that we conducted being inspired by that story of Lanyu Railway. So many of the readers or the audience might ask, what systematically predict localities' ability in localized bargaining, aside from anecdotes that shows connections, informal connections are important? So in my book, I categorize Chinese localities into two groups. In the book, I use the term cardinals and clerics for English reading audience, okay? But here I'm going to speak in the language of a China specialist. So for some cities, they have more bargaining power within the party state structure. In other words, they have more institutional power. But institutional power, bargaining power, is very difficult to measure. If I ask you who has the most bargaining power in your department, everyone knows have this idea, but it's very difficult to quantify. In China, there is this institution called concurrent appointment, in which a leader of a place can concurrently hold another appointment at one level above his own level. Okay, for example, in Jiangsu province, the party secretary of Jiangsu province, the party secretary of Suzhou, a municipality of the province, is concurrently a member of the provincial party's standing committee. So that person is not only a municipal leader, but in the same time, also a provincial leader. I argue that such concurrent appointment provide a very good proxy for localities' bargaining power in their pursuit to gain access to infrastructure. So first, such concurrent appointment reduce the hurdle to gain access to central leaders. Chinese bureaucracy function like the fine oiled machines. It follows the leadership meetings in China follows the principle of reciprocity, just like international diplomatic meetings. An official is only obligated to meet his exact counterpart. Okay, so if a city leader without concurrent appointment, a regular municipal leader visit Ministry of Railway, then only a bureau leader is obligated to meet with his counterpart because they have the same rank. But now imagine if a city leader is also a provincial leader, then the minister will, or at least a deputy minister will have to meet with this person. So by design, this kind of concurrent appointment allows localities easier access to decision makers at higher level. But I also argue that such concurrent appointment also serves as a platform for agenda setting. So in China, when something is approved by, is regulated by the central government, only provinces can submit proposal to central government. So this means that if two cities are competing for a project, they first need to settle the argument or first need to settle the competition within the province. But if a city's leader is also concurrently a provincial leader, then the city can use these advantageous positions to set the agenda at the provincial level and then use the province as a platform to submit a proposal to the central government. So here I use the Hangzhou Bay Bridge as an example to illustrate how concurrent appointment can be used for agenda setting purposes. So this is Hangzhou Bay located on the east coast of China. And the northern, on the north part of the bay, on the north shore of the bay is Shanghai. And on the south shore is Shaoxing and Ningbo, two cities. Back in early 2000, the two cities on the south were competing for building bridges to connect to Shanghai. But both cities want their proposals to get accepted first by the central government. When Zhejiang provincial were discussing control for cities, size of economy, the population, and the size of revenue, and I only look at whether the city also has its leader holding a simultaneous leadership position in the provincial leadership. And I find that cities with such concurrent appointment, they were able to get more station and also have their station approved earlier than a similar cities nearby. Okay, I saw there are two comments in the comment sections. Okay, can you hear me now? Okay, yes, my apology for the intermittent connections. I think there are some connection problem on my end. Okay, but for those without institutional power, for the majority of Chinese localities, without such institution, without such advantageous positions within the party state, how do they get their voice being heard? So here I created another concept called consent instabilities. I will explain this a little bit later, but first I want to use this example. So in 2015, Sichuan provincial authorities announced they want to build a railway connects Dazhou and Chongqing. It's called the Dazhou Intercity Railways. And there are two plans being widely debated for this railway. So the West Blue Line will go through Qixian and Guan'an, and Guan'an is the hometown of Deng Xiaoping. If you remember the revolutionary story that I just tell you, you can guess which line eventually won in this competition. And the East Red Line will go through Dazhou and Lingshui. So in May 2015, Guan'an, the Sichuan provincial government says they will go with the blue plan, the west, with the west, the route. What happened after the announcement of this decision is protest immediately broke out two days after Sichuan provincial government's announcement. And we see in this picture, they broke out in the two cities on these protests. Second, we see these protests they were very well organized. We see people in streets, they wear similar t-shirt and they have banners prepared. And in Dachu, we see a very unusual scene. We see police, they coexisted peacefully with the protest, with the protesters, okay? And something very, even more unusual, we can't get from these pictures is that, so on the day that leading to the protest, there are already a lot of posts on local BBS organizing these events. But the local government in these two cities seems to do very little to prevent this event from happening. So for anyone who are familiar with Chinese politics, you will know this is very unusual because Chinese local government puts social stability as its top priorities. But in fact, such events are not an isolated incident. In the past two decades, we see similar high-speed railway protests occurring across China. For example, this is one protest occurring in Xinye, in Henan province in 2009. And this is another protest in Jingzhou in Hubei province in 2011. So I counted such protests and find close to 20 documented, which means these I can find pictures, I can find a newspaper report on these protests, and there are more such mobilization without documentations. So why Chinese local authorities, who are otherwise very strict on social stability maintenance, would allow such protests to take place? As shown in the last picture, we see local policemen, they're existing peacefully with these protesters. So in my book, I call these phenomena consent instabilities. I argue that local government strategically tolerate such spontaneous expression of demand for high-speed railways. And such protests, the protest in street, these kind of mobilizations serves as a costly piece of signals to the superiors in the central government and in the provinces. These kind of protests, they serve as a signal. Okay, so local government can talk to their superiors in a following manner. I really don't want high-speed railway. But now you see all these people in streets, right? We have to make a concession or we have to make a response to these people. If we don't make a response, if you don't make a concession, then you will be the person responsible for causing social stabilities that can further endanger regime stability. Okay, so we see in a country that prioritizes social stabilities, social instabilities can at times be used as the policy bargaining tools in intergovernmental relations. So in my book, I use a very detailed case studies to flesh out the logic of consent instabilities, but also I get questions. So does this really work in a large scale besides a few cases? So what I do is that, so I work at Peking University. So one advantage at my university is that a lot of local government are sending officials for short-term or long-term training. So what I do is that when I was teaching these classes, I pretend that as a part of the class assignment, I ask these students to fill out survey questionnaires. In these surveys, I embedded a survey experiment. Okay, so what I did is that I gave different vignettes to local officials and asked them if they were encountered with this kind of scenarios, whether they will make concessions to their subordinate and give resources to their subordinate. And in this vignette that are primed with social pressure, particularly social pressure that comes with collective actions, these officials are more likely to make concessions compared with other vignettes. So with this survey experiment, I'm more confident that these kind of strategy would actually work in China, okay? So when officials are faced with pressure from their subordinate, particularly if this pressure are coupled with potential of collective action by their constituents, then they're more likely to make concessions. So finally, I want to end my presentation with brief discussion of the implication of localized bargaining. I think in any organizations, China included, In any kind of hierarchical organizations, one important question is how subordinate can gain the attention of superiors. Gaining the attention of superiors is the very first steps of many other very good, beautiful things. For example, gain resources, getting promotions, et cetera. Okay, so oftentimes I joke in my class, I'm teaching a 300 student class in four semesters. But at the end of the semester, I only get to remember the names of perhaps 10 to 15 students. That's normal. That's, I think other faculties would have sympathies with me. I can't remember the name of 300 students. So I always reflect on what are the 10 or 15 students eventually I will remember. I think oftentimes two types of students whose name I will remember. One type of students are those who perform very well in class to the extent sometimes I often give them some tasks to help me organize class discussions, et cetera. So, okay, so these students, I call them the concurrent appointment, those with institutional bargaining power. Their positions in the classroom allow me easier access. So that's why I remember them. And the other type of students are those troublemakers who always make very weird comment in classrooms or never show up in the first half of class and only show up in the middle of the class, okay? These students, I also remember their names. So either these very well performers or these troublemakers. And I say, isn't this the story of what happens in China with regard to policy bargaining in railway investment? Those with advantageous positions within the party state or those who are able to strike big troubles to have their requests being noticed by their superiors. The second thing I want to talk about is the information problem in governance. So China is a very large country, equivalent with the size of European countries. Place differ significantly in their endowment, in their levels of economic development, et cetera. Governing a such large country naturally generates information problem. For decision maker at the central levels, how can they make informed decision? It requires information, as I discussed in my presentations. So, but these information, they don't come out of vacuums. Where are these information come from? I argue in my book that localized bargaining is the mechanism to generate such information. When local government are lobbying their superiors or trying to bargain for a deal for their localities, they are also sending information to their superiors, okay? In these interactions, they let their superiors know the levels of development in their localities and why they need such public infrastructures and the degree to which they want these kind of infrastructure investment. And these informations are very important for informed decision makers at higher level. So even though I understand that many would associate intergovernmental lobbying with distortion of resources or corruption, I would argue that these activities are very crucial in a country, in a very large country like China, without other forms of institution that provide decision maker in the center with sufficient information of localities to make informed decisions. Finally, I think this is also one form of power sharing. In the past decade or so, power sharing in non-democracies is a very important topic in comparative politics. People have talked about how institutions such as constitutions, such as parties, serve functions to credibly share power among authoritarian elites. So in my book, I also talk about how bureaucracies, particularly a hierarchically structured bureaucracies, also serve the functions of credibly committing elite to share power with one another. And these factors, when we're taking up these factors together, they collectively provide us a picture on why China can grow despite the lack of many institutions that people believe are necessary for good governance. My apology for being over time, and that's all for my presentation. Thank you for your patience, and I look forward to your questions.
Okay, this is such a fantastic talk. I think this is one of the, I think, great studies with not only the theory, but also a lot of details. Like I can tell, Xiao has done some of the most amazing fieldwork, especially to get access to conducting survey experiments on local officials in China, and also like conducting some of the in-depth interviews with the local officials. It also, like, this concept of localized bargaining also made me think that actually in management science, sometimes people talk about this concept of managing up, 向上管理. Basically, mm-hmm. it's how, rather than be managed by your boss, like how to manage your boss so that you can create a partnership to in terms of problem solving. I think our existing understanding in China, of course, people have done a lot of research in this area, but I think a lot of research has still like a focus on this top-down management style from the central to the local governments. But Xiao actually shows another direction of management, basically how the local governments bargain with the central governments and get what they want. All right, so let's open this talk to Q&A. If you have any questions to ask, please raise your hand.
Oh, hi, Professor Ma. Thank you very much for the interesting presentation. So this is Yue Tong. I'm a Georgetown alumni. I'm currently working for the World Resources Institute, especially on the e-mobility issues. And not being selfish, but could you tell me like the Chinese translation for concurrent appointment?
Uh-huh. Okay, so the concurrent appointment, if we have a verbatim translation as 兼职, okay, so means you have two positions, but in that specific context, I would use 高配, which means you have another positions at higher level.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you for the answer. And another question would be, you deliberated a lot on like how local or provincial or city leaders can have motivation for proposing transportation projects to higher levels. But I would be very interested in knowing your opinion or suggestions for subordinates, which mm-hmm. you mentioned a lot in the presentation, like how to motivate them to be able to kind of like propose to like the city and provincial leaders.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Thanks for the question. So as I said, so these subordinates, they're not bound by these cadre evaluation per se, but they want the same thing as everyone wants. For example, they want a larger end of year bonus, okay? They want the larger paychecks. How to achieve this? As many of my great colleagues in the field of Chinese politics, they find out if your department can carry out more tasks, if you are able to pull these project, if a leader were able to pull this project to the localities, then this department will be busy. And then these transportation related department, their personnel, they will get a larger end of year bonus. They will have additional incomes. These are all legal income, let alone the informal, the illegal income, as I just mentioned, they can also benefit from, for example, contracting opportunities for their friends and family members. And also, For these departments, they will need to hire more personnel. And in fact, in China, the size of the payroll, the amount of people these departments were able to hire is a very crucial reason why these departments wants to have this project. If I can employ more people, they can have these vacancies be filled by their, for example, close friends or relatives. And how can they have these opportunities is they have to also have to have done a lot of project in order to have their payroll being expanded. I think these constitute very concrete incentives for these departments, even though they can never, they don't need to care about this project per se, but for this material incentive, they will push their superior to pursue this project.
Very interesting thoughts. And I think my last question would be, you presented on a lot of stakeholders, government stakeholders, such as NDRC, MOR, MOT, MOEE. Just curious to know, like, eventually, where does the money come from when building those railways?
Thank you. This is a very good question. So all these railways, so when a railway is built, a temporal company will be established just for the construction of that railway. That's a project company. And oftentimes the Ministry of Railway, now the China Railway Corporation, will take 51% of the shares. And the local government, oftentimes the province that are on the path of the railway will take the remaining 49%. And the province will provide their capital in the form of bank loans. So they will use their land as collaterals to leverage loans from the bank. And the central government will directly offer capitals to the Ministry of Railway for their share of the capital. So the reason the Ministry of Railway have to be the main shareholder is because after the railway is completed, the ownership of the railway and as well as the operation will be controlled by the Ministry of Railway. So they can have a unified national network instead of those smaller network controlled by local government. This will create a lot of smaller blocks. But in China, the entire network is operated by the China Railway Corporation or the central government.
And then like when the ownership shift back to the Ministry of Railway, because the railways are located in the localities, right? For like operation and maintenance, do the local government take charge of that, or that's
no? So these railways, they were exclusively maintained, operated by the Ministry of Railway, now the China Railway Corporation. To the extent, this is something very interesting. So the Ministry of Railway used to have their own police and prosecutors. So if a crime happened in a train, for example, someone stole my luggage on a train, I shouldn't report to the local police station where this crime was occurred, but instead I should report to the railway police because that crime occurred on the railway. So the railway system was once called an independent kingdom inside of China, because anything I think within 30 meters of a railway are managed completely by the railway. I think the only time a local government can participate in railway management is during the pandemic control. So they will have to, for example, check the PCR test when passengers are entering railway stations. But otherwise, the entire railway system are operated independently by the Ministry of Railway.
Oh, thank you, Professor. And this is very interesting conversation. And because our team...
I'm sorry, I have to interrupt you there because we still have other questions. Let us go back to you if other students, other people like don't have questions anymore, okay? All right, Andrew, do you want to ask your question?
Yeah, sure. Hi, thank you, Professor, for a great talk. As I said in the chat, a lot of times when the federal or even state government in the American system wants to undertake a big project like high-speed rail, housing, highways, et cetera, it oftentimes is frustrated by local activists, people who, like you said, you know, they're afraid about property values, about nature, about their neighborhood. And they're in the American system, they're able to be very effective through lawsuits, through petitions, and through other means of, it's amazing, you know, you have this huge federal government, but it's able to be stopped by a few citizens at the local level who are really dedicated. And I'm curious to know if it sounds like the same thing happens in China. And I'm curious to know if you think that's a fair comparison, because to me as an American, when I think of China, I think of it as a one-party place where the central government gets what it wants eventually, but it sounds like locals still have a fair amount of power. And so I'm curious to know if you think that the problem is similar, it's equal across the American and Chinese systems, or if the Chinese system has tools for overcoming those NIMBYs, we call them, in a way that Americans don't, or vice versa.
Thank you, Andrew, for this very good question. The protest I mentioned in my presentation and in the book, one journalist at Foreign Policy called it reverse NIMBY, so police in my backyard. So these people are protesting in order to pull this project to their backyard. But to answer your question, there are people who are against this project. I think there mostly these are two groups of people. The first group of people are those whose livelihood will be affected by the construction of the railway. Mostly are those whose farmland or household will have to be demolished to make room for the railway. This happens a lot, especially in the rural areas. So what happened, so as I mentioned in my project, in my presentation, local government are highly motivated to pull this project to their localities, and they want this project to be done as quickly as possible in order to generate growth, et cetera. So what these local government do is that they send in these demolition team, also in the same time they send in police. If these people are going to petition higher level officials, they will use these coercive methods. Okay, so this is what typically happens in China with regard to people who have grievances regarding land requisition. And the second group, as I mentioned, in fact, I briefly mentioned in my presentation, are those who live in large urban area. For example, those urban residents in Beijing, they were the person who sent petition letters to the Ministry of Environmental Protection saying the construction of this railway will produce a lot of noise because, you know, the high-speed railway travels at 300 kilometers per hour. When they pass by, it generates a huge amount of noise. So when these urban residents, they submit complaint letters to these ministries, in most of the occasions, these concerns will be dealt in a more serious manner compared with the previous example, the land requisition examples. So in the case I mentioned, in the Beijing's case, local government were forced to redesign the routes four times in order to avoid this densely populated area, and also to change the outlook of the railway. They have to build a cover over this railway in order to absorb all the noises. So in order to meet the demand of these citizens. So in this regard, I think it's very similar to what happened in the United States. As I just mentioned, because the Beijing residents, they were sending these letters to the Ministry of Environmental Protection, the construction of the railway was delayed for 4 years. So that's very similar to what you just mentioned in the United States. And I expect such incidents will increase in the future as more and more urban residents are increasingly aware of the environment. Thank you for your question.
Hi, Professor. Can you hear me? Okay. And I'm a graduate student in Georgetown University and I study in real estate. And I have a question regarding the your topic about the railway station investment, because I think it's a result for the bargaining process. So, but from my experience, it's a kind of investment result. And do you have any study? Do you have any study from the financial perspective? Because for your reference, for the Jiangsu province, I think the debt level to compared with the GDP is the most hardest in China. And so it's kind of the public debt market. And another side is from the sale of land plan. And because every station, the local government should invest, 49% capital to each station. So, it's kind of another perspective for the results. Can you share with me?
Yeah. Thank you, Charlie, for this question. I think you are touching upon another aspect of the so-called the China growth model, right? So the China's growth model also come with government-led investment in infrastructure, but the other side of the story is the accumulation of the debt. I think you are correct to mention that The debt to GDP ratio in China is almost as high as that in Japan, even though China's per capita GDP was only 1/4 of Japan, but we are already at the debt ratio similar to Japan. I think for high-speed railway, we need to look at this question in two parts. So I read the World Bank's in 2019, the World Bank also released a report on their evaluation of the economic return of high-speed railways. So if we are only look at a project per se, a lot of these projects accumulate significant amount of debt. So it seems a less sustainable way of development in the short term. But we also need to think about these public projects in a more holistic approach. For example, it reduce carbon emissions. Also, it reduce people's travel time. Okay, so when we only look at the project per se, think about these tickets, the income will not generate enough revenue to pay off the debt, even the interest, let alone the principal. But we need to think about the overall social return, right? Whether they were able to think, we're able to recap the amount of debt generated from this. I think the 2019, the World Bank report, they evaluated 6 high-speed railway, mostly in the more densely populated area. They think it's worse, if we factor in this kind of social return, they think it's economically worthwhile. But I don't know if this would apply to other projects, particularly in those sparsely populated region. China is now also expanding its railway network. I think that's a good question to ask. If we look at Japan, so the example I used in Japan is that for Japanese politicians, they were able to willing to invest the railway in a very sparsely populated area. Even a railway station for one passenger will be invested just to for electoral purposes. And that, many scholars of Japan argue that is the reason for Japan's lost decade for the accumulation of debt in Japan, government, particularly government debt. I think China is on a path, on a similar path, but not to that extent. I think if you follow Chinese political economy closely, I think back from 2016, the Chinese government purposely also are working on deleveraging, trying to decrease the amount of government debt or to try to control risk associated with accumulation of government debt. But I don't know how they will, how this will fare in the future. It's a question to be answered. It's a question to be observed, or rather we can answer at this point. Thank you for your question.
Okay, thank you.
I have so many questions, but I want to give the audience like first chance if anyone has more.
I also have a question, have questions, but I will ask after Ning.
Okay. Right.
So I'll go. First of all, like Xiao, congratulations on such a rich book.
Thank you.
Like, so many components. It's so like interesting. And you clearly, you didn't mind like getting our, you know, you get a lot of your work done. So obvious. So I have like a few questions, and the first one is actually about the concurrent appointment. So I wonder, and I don't know at all about this, but is it possible that most people who get a concurrent position at the provincial level would also be party secretaries and mayors in the richest and the most powerful cities in the province? Because if that is the case, then what it might be telling us is still that railway is more likely to happen for the economically vital cities rather than lesser. So I wonder about that. And then another thing is, so your description of protest, which I thought was, it's the Chinese political logic. Like I find it very convincing. And then it reminds me of another research. I think it's by Steinhardt, I'm not sure, but there were people who find that local governments nowadays in China actually, they launch protests. It's a grassroots kind of protest, but they're organized by the government to get public projects done exactly like we described when the central government doesn't want to give them those projects. So I wonder if you observe any of those at all on the ground. So I'll start with those. And then I have some questions on China-US comparison, but I'll leave that later. Yeah.
Thank you, Ning, for these very good questions. So actually, I think you asked the exact same thing as my book reviewers, which makes me wonder if you review my
book. I'm not. No.
You were one of the reviewers. So the first question is indeed, I think, one of the toughest to answer. Indeed, for most of these concurrent appointment, they goes to these economic or population center in a province. So the provincial capital, the party secretary of provincial capital, they always sits in the provincial party standing committees. So what I did in my analysis is that I do three things. First, I already control for provincial capital. So I'm trying to parse out if the effect were driven by provincial capital alone. I also account for the total size of GDP, the size of population, as well as the size of revenue, in order to account for whether these projects are favoring population center or economic center already. The third thing is that some cities in this period of observation from 2004 to 2020, they gain and lose the status of concurrent appointment. For example, the city of Xiangyang, that's a city in Hubei province, they gained the status of concurrent appointment in 2007, 2008, but they lost afterwards. So when we compare within a city, so that gives us the leverage to conduct within city comparisons. I think with these three methods, I can ameliorate a little bit the concern that you just mentioned, but I understand I always get this, and the reviewer asks the same thing as you just do. What I can say is that I try to control as much as possible, and also control within the city. The same city when it has concurrent appointment and doesn't have a concurrent appointment. So that's my response to you. And the second thing, I think you ask a very good question. So in Chinese political system, if you were found out by your superiors that you were launching, that you were actually behind such a protest, that will result in serious disciplinary actions. One very good example is in 2005, also in Hubei province, in Daye. So Daye was a county city under Huangshi municipality. So in that year, the municipality tries to turn Daye into a district, or 撤县改区. So, but Daye, county government doesn't want that. So they orchestrated a protest against that decision. But that move was too obvious. And after a very easy investigation, the party secretary, the county executive, as well as the chair of the county's People's Congress were fined directly behind that protest, and they were all removed from office. So it's an action against the party organization, 反对党组织决定. So that's very serious. And even if we think about in simple bargaining terms, if the protest is easily orchestrated, then the protest per se is not credible. So we all see these anti-American protests in North Korea, right? But we all know these protests are not spontaneous, and they actually help North Korea very little in international bargaining. But the same thing would be very different, for example, if we see an anti-China protest in Vietnam, then that protest actually would change something if a diplomatic talk take place between Chinese and the Vietnamese government. So I wrote this a little bit in my book, is that local government has to be invisible in these protests. They need to be appear to be neutral or unaware of the organization per se. But in fact, in most of these protests, as far as I know, so I visited some of these places and talked to the person involved in these events, it's always local government without the permission of local government. So if we study social movement, it's about opportunity structure. Like, where is the opportunity structure come from? It's always local government are giving them the permission to do this.
Or acquiescence, but, right?
Yes, but even how are these signals being given? I find in the case such as Ling Shui and Dazhu, the local business association played a very important role, because on the surface, local business association, they are not part of the government, but local private entrepreneurs, particularly influential entrepreneurs, they are highly dependent on the state. The officials can give them direct directives or give them signals, implications for them to organize those in the front, and they can be shielded from any accusations.
I find the same thing in my work. I'm going to read that chapter from
you. You should like co-author a paper because I think this is super interesting.
Yes, I think this is how public opinions are being used in China to achieve policy purposes. I think this actually is very common in China along different policy domains. I'm glad you find the same thing. Help me validate my argument.
Likewise, that's great.
Ning, do you want to ask your last question or I can ask another question before
you go ahead? You go ahead, yeah.
Yeah, so Xiao, I also found the consent instability a fascinating concept because I think there's definitely a trade-off. One is that the protest has to be, you know, costly in some sense and also needs to have the risk, run the risk of going out of control, right? Otherwise it wouldn't be credible. But on the other hand, the local government probably need to also be able to control the size of it. So in that sense, it will help the local government to bargain for a station. I actually have a question. Which is the whole work, I mean, like all these like a localized bargaining thing seem to assume that having a local station will be beneficial to their economic development. This makes sense. I mean, if you think about the KPIs that the local officials have to, you know, fulfill economic development and GDP, but also some other work, for example, work by Ben Faber basically found that, you know, when you build this national trunk system, for example, when you connect big cities with smaller cities, actually the connected smaller cities will lose simply because if you think connection will bring dispersion of production and economic growth, it actually facilitates concentration. In other words, people in the smaller cities even countryside would make them more easy to travel to this like bigger cities because they all want to live in big cities. So do local officials actually know this? Because when they have a local station, they actually lose rather than, you know, win in the long run. Or do they care about this?
Thanks, that's a great question. So in fact, if you look at economics papers, so economists only cares about the economic consequence of high-speed railways. So I remember Yao Yang, who is an editor of China Economic Quarterly. He complained in 2019 that half of the submission to Jingjixuejikan, the Quarterly Journal of Economics in Chinese, not in English, the Quarterly Journal of Economics in Chinese, were about the economic consequence of high-speed railway. And I read some of these papers and most of the paper agree with what you said. And people actually find that it has such a drainage effect that it actually drains people from smaller cities, move people from smaller cities to larger cities. But we need to bear in mind that these effects only take effect after the railway is completed. Okay, so I remember Pierre Landry, et cetera, they find that the average tenure of Chinese mayors are 3.4 years. And usually a high-speed railway, the construction takes place in the middle of an official's tenure, and oftentimes takes 4 or 5 or 6 years to complete. So when the railway completes and when the drainage effect actually takes place, it's already say 7 years from the beginning of the construction and someone else has already take that position, they will be suffering from that consequence in smaller places. So I remember our good friend Reed Lace, very good work. He finds that these officials, they are not benefiting from the long-term economic consequence of this project. They're mostly benefiting from the immediate return on this project. Mostly are fixed asset investment. When you have these projects in localities, you suddenly have a boost in investment, in contracting opportunities, and this will help local officials, their career. No one is going to wait for 8 years because on average, they only stay there for 3 years. Their successor will be bearing that consequence. But I think that explains very well the incentive structure. For me, I only need to care about whether I can generate growth in my tenure, that long-term consequence will be others' trouble.
This is great. You know, it reflects this like a general rationale of how sometimes political logic would deviate from economic logic, which we see so often in Chinese political economy. Okay, Ning, do you want to ask the last question? Or maybe Yue Tong will have more questions after this.
Yeah, I would let Yue Tong go. Yeah.
Oh, actually, yeah, I'm very interested in Ning's question on US-China difference, because that was something that I'm also interested in.
Yeah, please.
Okay, it's just a quick question that do localized bargaining not exist in the US, right? So I was talking to Li Zhi about this too, and we were just talking about in the US, it's not like they're directly competing for the favor of the superior, like in China, but they do worry about people, you know, moving from one place to another place, right? So people can choose to leave. So I'm wondering, like, what do you see as a fundamental difference in terms of bargaining?
So, yes, thanks. So in the US, most of these lobbyings, they happens to the legislator. So for example, local government, they will go to the state representatives or the House of Representatives that are representing their district, arguing if you can help pull some earmarks to our district. And these visits, these lobbyings, according to US laws, they have to be documented, and you can actually search these visits, these lobbyings by local government. And there's a website called Open Secrets that documents all the lobbying activities by firms, by associations, and by local governments. And I also think in the US, you don't need to have consent instability. You only need to send electoral signal to the legislator. That's enough, right? Precisely in China, because we don't have such information mechanisms, then you have to generate other signals to remind your superiors that we need policy favors, we need a policy response here. So I think that's the biggest difference. In China, all these things are taking place behind closed doors without documentation. So that's why I think it's very difficult to study, but also very interesting to study. You get all these anecdotes, but without knowing the whole pictures. So all these things that I try to do are not actually studying these action per se, but studying the implication, what they demonstrate, that their consequence will be, but not its actions per se. These actions, they're only taking place. I once joked to my friend, if I actually get to attend one of these meetings, I should quit my job and start business, because I know these persons and I know where the project will be located. But in the US, these things are all public information. So now there are already a lot of papers published out of this data set.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. Like the informal bargaining process is, yeah, what I found too in my last paper. They absolutely do a lot of the, under a table deal.
Right.
Okay, does anyone have more questions? If not, let's thank Xiao again for giving the talk.
Thank you so much for inviting me. That's a great
pleasure. Yeah, I already bought the book.
Pleasure to talk to you.
If you want to buy the book and read this fantastic book, please. It's available
thank
on
you.
Amazon. All right.
Thank you, Xiao. This is great. Yeah, thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Ning. Thank you, Li Zhi, for this.